All right. Welcome back to Codex. Today's speaker is Professor Marcin Bownik. Marcin received his PhD from Washington University in 2000 under the direction of Richard Rochberg. After a postdoc at the University of Michigan, he began his current position at the University of Oregon in 2003. Professor Bownik is a world-renowned expert in shift-invariant subspaces, anisotropic Hardy spaces, and multidimensional wavelets. But Marcin is always game to tackle new problems, and this has led to significant contributions on the HRT conjecture, the Kadison-Singer theorem, LCA group frames, and Schur-Horn theorems, just to name a few. Needless to say, we're very happy to have him here today to speak on some of his recent work on structured frames. Indeed, it's not hyperbole to say that this seminar probably wouldn't exist without him, since he advised half of all Codex organizers. All right, take it away, Marcin.
Yes, thanks a lot, John, for a nice introduction. It's of course a pleasure to speak. And yeah, when you mentioned about the results, I mean, when Hugo Steinhaus was once asked, what is his biggest mathematical discovery? Do you know what was the answer that he gave? I mean, maybe you haven't heard this joke from me, or maybe you haven't heard this joke today from me, but yeah. So Hugo Steinhaus, of course, is known for principle of uniform principle in Banach spaces, and but his answer was that his biggest mathematical discovery was Stefan Banach, right? I mean, so maybe yeah, okay. So well, I can probably say that two of my biggest mathematical discoveries are alive here during this talk. I mean, John and Joey. I mean, it's a pleasure. I'm really happy that they organized this seminar and they are very active in research, and they are doing other things that probably are my interest, but main interest, but still very nice. So what I will talk about is actually the joint work with Joey that we started when it was a nice collaboration that we started soon after Joey left Oregon when he was postdoc at Maryland, and we already finished that. So it will be a little bit abstract, but we'll talk about multiplication invariant operators, so, and then a result about classification of abelian group frames. So that's the abstract. Maybe I will not read about this, but essentially we'll talk about those multiplication invariant operators that will act on that space. It's L2 of X on a Hilbert space. And it's really abstract setting, so I'll try to convince you that this abstract setting is useful, that it's not just abstraction for itself, but because it somehow enables to encompass lots of the results about shifting our spaces, but somehow it gives also new results. And so so again, this talk is based on joint work with Joey Iverson. It's already published, so you can probably look up the paper if you wish. Okay, so what is the setup? So first I need to explain what are those multiplication invariant spaces. So we start rather abstractly from the separable Hilbert space H, and also a positive sigma finite and complete measure space that we denote by X, mu is the measure. We also assume that L2 with respect to that measure is separable. So it's really a nice measure that we have here. And now once we have this measure space and a bounded function, so function on infinity, we can talk about multiplication operator that I'll denote by M phi. So it's just a bounded operator. You take function, well, maybe it's a bit two phi's, one is, okay, but you multiply function phi by that other function phi. So since our function multiplier is bounded, yeah, this is a bounded operator. So now what is a multiplication invariant subspace? So we look at vector valued functions. So functions in L2 with values in a Hilbert space. So when you have a subspace of that, you say it's multiplication invariant. If you multiply that, if apply your multiplication operator for any function in L infinity, you land back in your space, right? Somehow the space is preserved by multiplications. And once we have two such multiplication invariant spaces, we can talk about operators between them. And these are just it's operator between V and V prime that commute with those with that multiplication operators. But so we'd like to understand how those spaces look like and how those operators look like. So, but before that, I need to give you two definitions. So the first is something called determining set for L1. So the definition is a bit technical, but okay, it's a subset of a dual. So it's a sub, so these are functions in L infinity, but they separate points in L1. So when you take any two functions in L1, which are different, F1 is not equal to F2, two distinct functions, you can always find a function G in your determining set so that those two integrals are not the same, they are different. So somehow, if you think of G as a functional on L1, so because functional on L1 are infinity, yeah, you can, so this that the set V is large enough so that it can separate points in L1. There's equivalent way of saying that that the span of this of that set determining set has to be weak star dense in L infinity. Okay, so that's determining set. And now what is a range function? So a range function, yeah, for those of you who have seen shifting spaces, this is a daily bread. For those who haven't seen, this is just an interesting mapping. It's a mapping on a measure space, but with values in closed subspaces of a Hilbert space H. So for every point in your X, you assign a closed subspace. So maybe when you think of this, if this is H could be finite dimensional, this is like a mapping with values in a Grassmannian, except this Grassmannian is not of fixed dimension. It's just the union of Grassmannians of all possible subspaces of all possible dimensions. But then it's not, often we assume that this red function has to be measurable. So what does it mean it's measurable? Okay, so you can look at the projection, corresponding orthogonal projection onto that space J of X. It's a mapping from your measure space into projections, and you assume that it's measurable. In what sense? Okay, weakly measurable or strongly measurable doesn't really matter. But maybe weakly measurable is the easiest to explain. You take two vectors in a Hilbert space, you look at this inner product, which is a square value function. It has to be measurable, no matter what choice vectors U and V you have. Okay, so these are definitions. Okay, so now what is the result of Helson and maybe an abstraction that this result that we have with Ken Ross, who is a retired professor at the University of Oregon. Maybe some of you know about his book, Abstract Harmonic Analysis, which is even, it was published before even I was born. So for me, it's almost like prehistory. Okay, so what Helson took is the following result. When you have a closed subspace, and you have this determining set V, the following are equivalent. So the space is multiplication invariant. So invariant under multiplications by any function in L infinity, but then it's equivalent to being invariant under multiplication just by this function, this determining set. So, I mean, one implies two is obvious, two implies one is non-obvious somehow. You need to somehow work yourself. I mean, if it's invariant under multiplication by some subset that will be invariant of L infinity, it's more invariant under all functions L infinity. But then the third characterization is the one due to Helson. You can always identify such multiplication invariant space by a range function, measurable range function. So you have this measurable range function and your space consists of all vector valued functions whose value at the point X belongs to that space. So somehow you, this J, capital J, this are subspaces like a, maybe like a roadmap where, and but then phi, the values of your function can take values in those subspaces, right? And any multiplication invariant space have to be of that form. It's given by some kind of range function. And you can maybe even say how this range function looks like, because if your MI space is generated by some functions phi I, then to get, and this phi I are again vector valued functions, they have values, they're functions on x with values in h. So what you can do for every x, you can look at the span. This is just a subspace of h, and that defines your range function. And this mapping actually, and then given the range function, you can define the space vj. And this is like a bijection, so you can, it's identification between multiplication-invariant spaces and those range functions, measurable range functions. You have to identify them if they are equal almost everywhere. Okay, so that's now examples. I mean, why do we even care about those range functions? So, okay, so let's come back to the year that I think before everyone, of maybe almost everyone that was born, 1964. I think this is the year my brother was born. Okay, so, well, maybe it's not fully prehistory for me, but Helson and Srinivasan talked about doubly invariant subspaces of L2 of X with Hilbert space H, where X is just the unit interval. So that's probably the easiest example. Let's take the simplest measure space, unit interval with the Lebesgue measure. What is the determining set? Complex exponentials. So this is orthonormal basis of L2 of X, scalar value L2 of X, and it will satisfy that property. These are bounded functions that separate points in L1. That's what, okay. So once you have this setup, I mean, you have this characterization. That's basically this result is due to Helson in that setting. Then De Boer, Ron in 1994 and myself in 2000, considered those shift-invariant spaces. So in spaces, subspaces of L2 of Rn that are invariant under integer shifts, right? So when a function f belongs to space, when you take it and translate the integer, that is of integers, you are back. So now you consider this fibrization operator that maps L2 of Rn into a vector value L2 on the unit interval with values in little L2. So what you do, you take the Fourier transform, then you sample this at the point x minus k. K ranges over integers. So what you get element of little L2 here for almost every choice of x. And then you get a vector valued function that maps x into that vector in little L2. And this is isometric isomorphism. And this isometric isomorphism enables you to translate shift invariant space into this multiplication invariant space, which is the image of that space D under T, because shift becomes multiplication. So, I mean, we know this shift in the time domain, space domain becomes multiplication shift by K by that complex exponential. That is just one dimension, but of course, you can, in higher dimensions, you have this e to the power 2 pi I inner product K against X. And your Hilbert space H here is little L2 of Zn. So again, if you want to study shift invariant space on V, you actually study multiplication invariant spaces, which are invariant under those complex exponentials, which form orthonormal basis of L2 of 0, 1. Okay, so once people realized that, then they start to talk about shift invariant spaces on discrete compact subgroup G of a second countable locally compact abelian group G, script G, right? Because, well, what we can do is the following. Rn is like this script G, like the space on which we consider our subspaces. And then shifts are given by what is the special about Zn. Well, it's a discrete subgroup of Rn. It's compact, so when you look at the quotient Rn over Zn, you get torus, which is compact. And then you can basically extend this machinery that was on Rn to that setting of LCA groups. So that was done in 2010. But then with Ross, we realized that, yeah, that's you can do this. You don't need discrete. You can consider only compact subgroups. And this fibrization operator will still work. And then Joey came along and he said, okay, you can cross co-compact. You just, the space, shifted space can be just a subgroup of second countable LCA group. And he even said something more. I mean, this was amazing for me that you can consider shifting spaces for an abelian subgroup of G of second countable locally compact group, but it doesn't have to be abelian, right? So the big group where all the shifts happen is not abelian, but then the subgroup is abelian. And then, yeah, Joey had this ingenious construction of this. You cannot use fibrization operator any longer. He constructed some kind of operator that was a very complete construction, composition of several, I mean, built of several simple operators. But then I thought, okay, we need to figure out what happens in the old classical city of RNZN. And then we check this, and this is Zach transform. Joey at that moment, I mean, maybe didn't know even what the Zach transform is. I mean, now he knows better, but he didn't know what the Zach transform is. And basically he rediscovered Zach transform that general city. I don't know how you call that. He even insisted on calling this by some other name, but I said to him, no, this is just, this is one thing that I insist. No, you have to call it Zach transform, because that's the setting of good RN and subgroup ZN. That was actual Zach transform. Maybe Joey will have more comments, but maybe now or after. But that's, I hope I'm not making up that story. I think that was. Okay, so these are the examples where this multiplication-invariant spaces appear. But then we want to talk about operators that act between those multiplication-invariant spaces. So there is another level of abstraction. So we talk about range functions. Now we talk about range operators. So we have two range functions. So this mappings on measurable space with values in closed subspaces of H. But now we have a range operator that is a choice of linear operators that acts between those spaces J of X, J prime of X. Because at each X, these are the subspaces. And you can talk about linear operators that acts on those, I'll call this fibers. And we want this to be, R to be, first of all, bounded. So somehow we want these operators to be somehow uniformly bounded. We look at operator norms of this, like essential supremum, this is bounded. But we also want this to be measurable. And measurability is a bit technical, but essentially you take this range function, projections corresponding to range function, and then for any U and V in a Hilbert space, I think this, I can probably erase this. This shouldn't be prime, because, except I am not sure if I can erase this that easily. Maybe if I switch to a different color, like white, I can make it disappear. Okay, let's play that. Okay, so when you have two vectors, this is scalar valued function has to be measurable. So now one observation is that once you have a bounded measurable range function, range operator, you can define a multiplication invariant operator. It's called the composable operators for those of you who have known some kind of direct integrals. That's the notation that we use. It basically what it does. So this is a long expression, but it's an operator acting globally on the space Vj given by the range function, multiplication invariant space given by the range function. So it's given, the action is given like on fibers. So once you have function phi, the value, and you want to know what is value at y, you look only what is the value of phi at y, and then you apply your range operator at y. Right? So it's like it's given pointwise, like a pointwise action. And now the result that we have, which is probably not surprising, it again follows from some results about Dirac integrals, but maybe in that setting we can put our names, is that every operator is of that form. So when you have two multiplication invariant spaces that are given by range functions, and then you have a bounded linear operator between those two multiplication invariant spaces, of course you have this determining set D, the formulas are equivalent. So T is multiplication invariant operator, so it commutes with all multiplications by anything functions, or it commutes with multiplications just by these functions in the determining set. Or the third one is that it is given by measurable range operators. So it's of that special form, a direct integral of those R of X, which is direct integral of the range operator. In fact, this mapping from the R to the range operator to that global operator gives one-to-one correspondence between bounded measurable range operators, because these are those R's, and multiplication invariant operators that are denoted by this direct integral notation, provided that we identify functions, operators that are equal almost everywhere. Okay, so this is very abstract result. But then what are the consequences, or at least if you want to know, there is something, I didn't put that slide, but there is this analogy between multiplication of operators and range operators comes very deep. I mean, it's like isomorphism of categories, where you have category of multiplication invariant spaces and the morphism of this multiplication invariant operators. And then the other category is range functions with morphisms given by range operators. So we know that basically the property, the global properties of this operator V, T, that this multiplication invariant operator, are reflected by the pointwise local properties of the range operator R. So if the operator T is bounded, then we know that R is bounded. That was especially that slide, like, or maybe the previous slide, if you still, this is the problem, if you can see only one slide at a time, or unless, okay. But then if the operator, let's say, if the global operator is bounded from below, this is actually equivalent to those local operators being bounded from below, but uniformly, right? So there is this uniform bound C, and that happens for every X and for every vector V in the range function of X. Now, T is going to be invertible if only R of X is invertible, but somehow uniformly. So when you look at the inverses, those inverses have uniform norm also bounded. Now, when you look at the adjoint of that operator V, V prime, it will map between V prime and V. But it corresponds to range operator that's just the adjoint. It's given point. So this R prime of X, this is given, it's a range operator which is, it's adjoint, but at a local level. So for, at every X, you have operator between J and J prime, right? So then you take adjoint and you, that's how it's given. T is unitary if and only if R of X is unitary. These are just consequences of a null theory. That's maybe one thing, maybe theory will finally forget about itself. I don't know how. Yeah. Okay. So then T
one
is.
Moment.
Yeah. So theory will distract us for a second. So T is unitary if and only if R at each fiber we have unitary operator. Let's see if I can make it disappear. Maybe somebody else knows how to do that.
One sec.
Yeah. How to make sure that it disappeared. So that's the same, the property number five, T is normal if and only if at each fiber you have a normal operator. T is one to one if and only if at each fiber the operators are one to one, maybe not each, but almost every fiber. T is isometry if and only if R of X is isometry. T is partial isometry if and only if R of X is partial isometry. So basically, any property of the operator, global property of T that you can think of, is reflected by the same property happening locally, but maybe not all property. I think what is, and this is warning, so maybe what is not true, let's see if I can make it work. So what is not true, so T is onto, so maybe that's, let's see if I can make it. For some reason I cannot switch back off, okay, I can switch the color. So T is onto, so this is not equivalent to R of X. It's onto almost everywhere. Well, if I want to be precise, so maybe, okay, what I can do is the following. Maybe I can do colors. So in green means that we can go, right? So there's one direction we can go. If T is globally onto, then locally, this operators R of X are going to be onto. But then if you have a local property that each of this operator R of X is onto, it's not true that global operator will be onto. Right? I mean, so it's not all of the properties of operators are reflected, but pretty much at least eight of them are. So, and many more probably you can. There is another result that's somehow important for us. I mean, also involving the spectra of multiplication invariant operators. So suppose we have an operator from V to V, that's the multiplication invariant operator. R is the corresponding range operator. So this is the like a local representation of this operator. Then the following are equivalent. T is going to be self-adjoint with the spectrum contained in that interval from A to B, if and only if at the local level, those operators R of X are self-adjoint with the spectrum contained in the same interval. It has to happen for almost every X. And this is generalization of this for normal operators. If you have a normal operator, well, first you take a compact set, and P is normal with a spectrum contained in a set K, if and only if R of X is normal with the spectrum containing the same set K. For those of you who don't know what a normal operator is, but probably you know, because otherwise you will not understand. But okay, normal just means, of course, that P star equals P star P. But then we have a spectral theorem, and we have we have a spectral theorem, and this is where this part three is about. Once we have spectral theorem, we also have spectral functional calculus. We can, and there are two flavors of functional calculus, either holomorphic or a bounded functional calculus. So when you have holomorphic function on some neighborhood of sigma of t, for that you don't need t to be normal. But for part B, when you have a bounded complex Borel function on the spectrum and you need t to be normal, then when you consider this functional calculus, so it's operator t, or h acting on operator t, it's other, this will be also multiplication invariant operator, and its corresponding range operator is given just by this operators which are given by you act by h locally on each fiber, right? So there is a like lots of analogy between multiplication invariant spaces and operators and those corresponding range operators and range functions. Okay, so hopefully in the second part of the talk, I'll give you some more applications. But before I give you more applications, we need two frames, because this is, after all, I mean, pretty much in all talks in this seminar, this definition and frames appear. I need to define a concept that was actually introduced by Joey. It's a Parseval determining set. It's a strengthening of this. It's not only determining set, but it's also Parseval. So it's a Parseval identity. So it's a collection of functions, g of t, indexed by some measure space y. They are again functions at infinity as in determining set. But first of all, we have this function g of t, some are chosen in some kind of measurable way, so that when you consider this mapping from a t to g of t, but you have to hit against f in L1 so that you have scalar value function. So this is weak measurable. So okay, so it's when you hit against L1, it's measurable function. And then you have something like, which looks like a partial formula and partial theorem or passive identity, because what you do is the following. When you take the inner product of f against g of t, and then when you integrate this with respect to this measure nu on y, then you get back the norm of f, alpha norm of f. This is true for all f in L1. So like the right-hand side could be equal to infinity, but the left-hand side also has to be infinity. But that's actually partial theorem, maybe in disguise, at least in what setting. X here is arbitrary measure space, y is also. But what will be interested really for most of the rest of the talk, well, but except maybe, is when the case, when in the case when X is actually locally compact abelian group, y is a dual equivalent partial measure, so that the characters will form possible determining set. So that's essentially what this will be what you see here will be a Fourier transform of function f. And then what you are doing here, you're completing the L2 norm of the Fourier transform. It's equal to the Fourier transform of the function itself. So that's the setting that we'll be mostly interested in. So once you have this Parseval determining set, you could be able to talk about frames of multiplications. So what we have a countable collection sequence in our vector valued space. We look at its multiplications by elements of our Parseval determining set. This is called system multiplications. We can look at the space, the smallest multiplication invariant space containing all these functions, so closed linear span of those. And then, this is given by the this multiplication invariant space corresponds to a range function given by locally by span of those values of fi. And this is the result of Joey that says that it's really nice result, because I mean, I knew this result is true for shifting invariant spaces, but now it's also true in this multiplication invariant setting. It says the following, the system of multiplications is framed with constants a and b for that space S of A multiplication invariant space, if and only if at a local level those vectors are frames, but with those uniform bounds A and B for those for the subspaces J of X. So basically the global property of that system is reflected by the local property, by global property of the that collection of vectors is a frame, is reflected by the global property happening on each fiber, but with the uniform bounds. So that's important. These are the same bounds in those cases. So this result of Joey is like a generalization of a series of results where people were proving these results, well, maybe first on settings of RN, then LCA setting and so on, and then Joey realized, yeah, this is this concept of personal determining set. You can have this measure theoretic result that's true for any measure space X. Okay, then this analogy comes deeper. So when you have, you can talk about frame operator that's given as a direct integral of frame operators acting on fibers. So that's, I would say, corollary of that result. Another corollary is that when you have two systems and suppose they generate the same space, then you can prove that, suppose these are four frames. I think just enough to assume that these are Bessel systems. Let's see. What I wrote is correct, but we can just assume Bessel, right? I think this is probably okay if you want to have marginal result. That the following are equivalent. These two systems of multiplications are dual frames. If only at the local level, they are dual frames. So you have this kind of results. But then what you have, I mean, is also classification of unitary equivalent frames. So you ask yourself when two frames are equivalent up to some action of unitary. So this is the result. So we have two sequences of functions in this vector valued space L2 of X of H. And we ask ourselves when there is a unitary a bounded operator that will map one system into the other. So that will happen if and only if this U is a multiplication invariant operator. So it's given as a direct integral of those unitary operators acting on fibers. But on those fibers, what you are doing here, I'm just mapping each of those phi i's onto the corresponding phi I prime. And this is a unitary, whenever that happens, we say that this is a frame, let's say this collection of the multiplication is a frame, we say that this is unitary equivalent to another frame. Because in a sense, we don't want to distinguish, or we want to identify frames which are unitary equivalent. And now unitary equivalence of frames of multiplications is the same as unitary equivalence of those on the fiber level. And we know that, two frames are unitary equivalence if they have the same Gramian. Right, because you look at the Gramian corresponding, but the indexing is, I guess, important because somehow this has to preserve the indexing. I keep the rigid indexing here, right? So, okay, so that's a corollary out of that. So now maybe one more definition of what it means for a Gramian to be integrable. So a Gramian is a positive operator. So it's an operator, multiplication invariant operator with values in positive operator. So it will be given by, again, at the fiber level, by at each level, it has to be positive operator, but it's integrable. So when you look at, I think it's enough to look at the diagonal actually. When you look at diagonal, it's a function of X, it has to be in L1. Automatically you will get that off-diagonal terms will also be integrable. And this delta I, this is just canonical basis of linear L2 of I, because that's where all function acts. So now what we have the following result. The unitary equivalence of Bessel systems is in one-to-one correspondence with this positive integrable multiplication invariant operators. Those Gramians, and those Gramians have to have rank less the dimension. In this correspondence, the Gramian of X is actually the Gramian of this multiplication invariant operator. And that's just more or less consequence of the previous result that tells you about unitary equivalence. Okay, so now let's maybe come. I hope the next slide will be. Oh no, the next slide is. I still want to talk about classification of frames of multiplication. Exactly. So a little bit more abstract here. So one definition. So when you have Hilbert space, a positive operator is called locally invertible. If it's, it may have zero in a spectrum, but then the rest of the spectrum is separated from zero. So it's containing the interval from delta to infinity. And now corollary of what we had before of this result that was before, I mean, maybe it's a bit, but maybe this is most interesting for people that are interested in the unitary equivalence of frames. So the unitary equivalence classes of the, of systems, of system multiplications that are frames for the post-linear span are in one-to-one correspondence with locally invertible integrable multiplication invariant operators that are acting on those vector valued space L2 of X with values in L2 of I, and they have ranks which are less than dimension of the space H that is here. Again, this correspondence, the Gramians of X is the Gramian at X is the Gramian of that tray. And then the next slide will specialize this to the case where our frames are Parseval frames. So when a frame is a Parseval frame, that corresponding Gramian will be a projection, right? And projections are somehow determined by the range, so by the low subspace. So that's what this will be about. So you can talk about measurable range functions that are integrable. So when you look at the diagonal terms, they have to be, this integral is finite. So then we have corollary that says that gives us classification of possible frames of multiplications. So when you talk about unitary equivalence class of, when you want to talk about unitary equivalence class of frames multiplications that are Parseval frames. So those Parseval frames are in one-to-one correspondence with integrable range functions. So again, range function that appeared in the first few slides, but they take values in closed subspaces of L2 of I. They have, there is this restriction of the dimension because that dimension is at most, can be at most H. And again, there is this correspondence that the Gramian of this phi of X is the same as, well, it's a formal projection onto J of X. So that's how far you can probably push yourself in this measure theoretic setting where X is the measure space. But now, of course, in the last 10 minutes of my talk, I would like to come back to the applications to LCA groups, because that may be the most interesting for. Okay, so what is the setting? Okay, so the setting is as follows. The space Y is G, a locally compact abelian group. I guess probably you need to make it second countable or just to be safe. X is the dual of that. So now what will be this Parseval determining set? Well, contracting duality tells us that the double dual of the space of the group G is back the same group G. So what we look at characters which we know by X hat. These are characters on G hat, and they are given by evaluation max. So this X hats are actually, if X is indexed by G, so these are just characters on G hat, and there are, you identify this with actually with elements of G because by contracting duality. So this is just, well, this is the set of characters on G hat. So this is the same as, so this D is actually like G. So this D is a Parseval determining set for in L1. So these are anything functions, but they also, because we have the Planchet theorem, then that's the correct setting to apply our result. But in order to apply our results, we still need to somehow translate that translate this to a setting of multiplication invariant settings. So what we will be talking about is the following. So suppose we have a representation of a group. So this unitary of unitaries on H. So now the following three are equivalent. That this you can serve, you can use one of those three conditions as a condition on the unitary representation that we have. So we assume that we have a sequence, let's say countable sequence in H, so that when you look at E of A, which is maybe I should have to define what is E of A, because let's say maybe E of A is on that slide. So maybe there is a way to copy and paste that. That's my mistake. I'm not sure if this copy and paste will work, but let's see. This is one advantage of the virtual blackboard. Okay, except I need to make sure that I can make it work. Copy. Okay, so let's come back to the slide. So then when I, that's what was missing from that slide. Okay, yeah. Okay, so what you do is the following. You look at the orbit of your vectors UI, except I didn't write what is, of course, maybe I need to also write what is A. So I was a little bit, I probably tried to put too much things on one slide. So my A here is, script A is just a collection of those vectors. So these are UIs. And that's a subset of H. So you have collection of vectors in H, and we apply our unitary representation to that, and we generate like an orbit under our representation. So the first condition says there exists a sequence like this, so that this orbits are a complete Bessel system. The second, or maybe the third one, is that once you can construct a Bessel system, you can actually construct a Parseval frame. And this is also equivalent to existence of some other separable Hilbert space K and linear isometry that maps H into L2 of G hat with values in K that intertwines pi with modulations. So here we have modulations acting on that group, and somehow the action of your representation on H corresponds to modulations. And this gives you the way to translate the results about those systems in terms of systems that will be acting on modulations. So we call such representation by pi admissible, and U is called, well, interpreter isometry, because somehow it enables you to, instead of talking about those systems, we'll be talking about modulations, that will be the Hilbert space that we'll be working on. Okay, so then, well, what are the group primes? Okay, so maybe I can, well, I still wanted to give that slide of that just for myself, but that's, we have collection of vectors, we have a representation, and this is an orbit. So this is the definition of what it means to be complete. The Bessel system, where you take any vector V, well, it's a continuous frame. So when you integrate over G, sum over all indices, you have a Bessel bound, and this is the frame condition where A and B are some constants. Except very often when the group G is discrete, this will be just a usual continuous, this will be a discrete frame, except here we need to talk about continuous frames. And these are abelian groups because they are given by the action of an abelian group G. G was a locally compact abelian group. And now we have this result about classification of abelian groups that says the following. By L2 of subscript N, I'll denote either a finite dimensional Hilbert space, L2 with N dimension, or this index is infinity, that will be L2 on natural numbers. So the following are, I would say, LCA versions of this measure theoretic classification result that we had a couple of slides ago. So if you want to talk about G systems, which are Bessel systems, or maybe frames, so these are two results in one, but we talk, you identify under unitary equivalence, right? And so the unitary equivalence that have N generators, they're in one-to-one correspondence with positive locally invertible and also integrable multiplication invariant operators on that L2 of G hat. So this is the dual with values in little L2 of N. So it's a little bit, many things come together, and but those slides were in, those definitions were in the early slides. But maybe what is the most interesting specification of this corollary when we talk about unitary equivalence classes of Parseval abelian group frames that have n generators. So those are in one-to-one correspondence with integrable range functions defined on G hat with values in closed subspaces of little L2 of n. So basically with the range functions of on G hat with values in L2 of n. So the range functions have again appears again, but in a completely different setting than initially. But because any range function defines like this defines a projection valued mapping on G hat. This projection valued mapping corresponds to this positive locally invertible because projection value integrable multiplication invariant operator on that, and that interpreter, well, that the interpreter U enables us to, well, it enables us somehow to interpret all these results that we had about multiplication invariant operators that were previous on previous slides, like that corollary, let's say, and maybe that corollary that we had about the Parseval frames multiplication that were in the very abstract setting of that measure spaces that have this Parseval determining set. We are able to interpret this in the setting of abelian group frames, and then you have this classification result. And I think, I hope you are lost in that talk. I mean, and if you are lost, that this is probably appropriate time to finish. And thanks for your attention. And I'll be probably ready to answer your questions.
Thanks, Marcin. So everybody, hit that reaction button. Thanks for the great talk.